If you'd been born in the US in the year 1900, when the three leading causes of death were all infectious diseases, pneumonia and flu, tuberculosis, and gastrointestinal infections, your life expectancy would have been just over 47 years. In the year 2010, the leading cause of death were chronic diseases like cancer and heart disease. We can thank improvements in sanitation practices and medical advances like vaccines for drastically reducing the impact of infectious diseases and extending our life expectancy to nearly 79 years. Before we learn exactly what a vaccine is and how they're made, let's discover how bacteria and viruses can make us sick in the first place. Both bacteria and viruses are microbes, tiny microorganisms that are too small to see with the naked eye. Viruses are smaller than bacteria. Most of the largest viruses are smaller than the tiniest bacteria. Both viruses and bacteria are spread by contact with infected people, animals, surfaces, or food, and both can cause diseases in humans that produce similar symptoms, like digestive upset, fever and chills, aches and pains, and respiratory distress. But despite those similarities, bacteria and viruses could not be more different. Bacteria are incredibly hardy living organisms. They can survive in nearly any environment and can reproduce on their own. Most bacteria are harmless to us, and many are actually helpful. Trillions of bacteria live all over our bodies, and scientists have recently discovered that our bodies might actually be only 43% human, and the rest of us made up of microscopic organisms like bacteria. Once a disease-causing bacteria has entered our system, it begins to reproduce and give off toxins, and it's these toxins that make us sick. Bacterial infections can be treated with antibiotics, which either kill the bacteria outright or limit its ability to grow. The bubonic plague, which killed 60% of the population of Europe in the 14th century, was caused by a bacteria. The Spanish flu epidemic of 1918, on the other hand, was caused by an aggressive strain of the influenza virus. A virus needs a host to survive and reproduce. Viruses make us ill by inserting their genetic material into our cells, causing those cells to burst and die or to mutate into malignant cells. It's nearly impossible to kill a virus once it finds a host. We can only treat the symptoms. The best thing we could do is try to prevent viral infections in the first place, and that's where vaccines come in. Now, before we can understand how vaccines work, we need to know a little bit more about our immune system. Our innate immune system's job is to monitor the body for pathogens and act as the first line of defense against infections. For the record, a pathogen is anything that can cause disease, like bacteria or viruses. An antigen is any substance capable of stimulating an immune response, which might only be part of a virus. Many organs and tissues are involved in our immune system. Our bone marrow is where the immune cells are born and constantly replenished. All immune cells start out as stem cells before developing into specific immune cells. Our lymph nodes are located strategically throughout our bodies, usually near openings where pathogens tend to enter, like our mouth or genital areas. Lymph nodes store immune cells to be deployed during an infection. The swollen nodes you feel when you're sick are the result of an increase in the number of cells in the tissue as your body ramps up its efforts to fight off the intruders. Our spleen filters pathogens from our blood as it circulates through our body, and our muscles contract to move air or liquids that contain pathogens out of the body by means of vomiting, diarrhea, coughing, or sneezing. Our skin acts as an important physical barrier against pathogens. The top layer of skin cells, called epithelial cells, line the openings of our body and are coated with mucus, a thick, sticky solution that makes it hard for pathogens to attach to our cells. The mucus coating also contains chemicals that help your skin maintain a slightly acidic pH, making it harder for viruses to survive. Some cells also have microfibers called cilia, which help move mucus and pathogens along the cell surface. Our nose hairs work similarly, filtering dust and other pathogens as we breathe. When a pathogen manages to sneak past our innate immune system, our adaptive immune system kicks in. The adaptive immune system reacts in specific ways to specific pathogens, whereas the innate immune system responds the same way to all threats. Antigen-presenting cells, or APCs, are produced in our bone marrow and monitor our bloodstreams for pathogens. When APCs encounter an unwanted intruder, they phagocytose it, breaking it into pieces and placing them on their surface before heading to the nearest lymph node to present the antigen signal and kickstart the full immune response. The signals from the APCs activate T cells, which oversee cytokine signaling. Cytokines are small proteins that fit perfectly with receptors on specific cells and give that cell instructions to help regulate the immune response. They may tell cells to grow, change, or reproduce, or instruct them to kill other cells infected by the virus. B B cells are a type of immune cell that multiplies rapidly and secretes antibodies or immunoglobulins, or IG, which are proteins that target and kill invading microbes. Once the infection has been dealt with, all that remains of your adaptive immune cells are a small number of T and B memory cells. After the primary immune response to the first exposure to the illness or to a vaccine, those lingering memory cells will make your secondary response to the same pathogen stronger and more effective, meaning future infections will be less severe, shorter, and may not present any symptoms at all. But now that we understand how our body fights off pathogens on its own, let's learn about how vaccines leverage our immune response to combat infections. So, what exactly is a vaccine? A vaccine is a compound that contains a killed or weakened version of a pathogen that is known to cause disease in humans. The vaccine won't make you sick, but it will stimulate an immune response. Unlike medicines that treat disease, vaccines work by preventing the infection in the first place. The immune response triggered by the vaccine produces the same memory cells that a true infection would, which teaches your body how to effectively deal with the pathogen in the future, without the risks of having to get the disease first. Edward Jenner is credited with the first successful use of a modern vaccine in 1796 when he used cowpox material to inoculate a 13-year-old boy from smallpox. Louis Pasteur is another vaccine superstar credited with creating the first successful rabies vaccine in 1885. He's also famous for developing the process of pasteurization, which kills disease-causing microorganisms in food and beverages by heating them to a certain temperature. But the history of vaccines actually goes much farther back. Evidence suggests that the Chinese employed smallpox inoculation as early as the year 1000. Technically, this was variolation, not true inoculation, since their technique involved smearing open tears in a patient's skin with true cowpox, rather than a weakened version designed for vaccination. By the 1930s, vaccines and antitoxins were available for diphtheria, tetanus, anthrax, cholera, plague, typhoid, tuberculosis, and more. By the later half of the 20th century, thanks to the success of vaccines and vaccination programs, many previously deadly diseases had been all but eradicated in much of the world. Although the way vaccines work may seem simple in theory, creating a vaccine is actually quite complicated. First of all, the costs are astronomical. It could cost upwards of $1 billion and take more than 10 years to develop an effective new vaccine that we can be reasonably sure won't cause the disease. On top of that, viruses are constantly mutating, and we are constantly encountering new strains of the viruses like the flu. It's almost impossible to predict which strain will hit in a given year, and by the time an outbreak hits, there's usually not enough time to create a vaccine. For viruses that are more stable over time, there are many different methods for creating a vaccine. The method used depends on the pathogen being targeted, whether it's a virus or a bacteria, and the way it causes disease in our bodies. Live, attenuated vaccines are created by weakening the virus so that it responds more slowly in our bodies, giving our immune system time to learn how to respond to the intruder without letting the disease run rampant. Normally, viruses replicate thousands of times, but attenuated viruses will only reproduce about 20 times, enough to stimulate the creation of memory cells without making you sick. The measles, mumps, and rubella, chickenpox, and some flu vaccines are all live attenuated vaccines. Live attenuated vaccines are made by passing the virus through a series of cell cultures or animal embryos up to 200 times. With each pass, the virus gets better and better at replicating in the culture or embryo, but worse at replicating in humans. The virus will still be recognizable to your immune system, but won't be able to replicate well enough in your body to cause disease. The advantage of live attenuated viruses is that one or two doses is usually sufficient to provide a lifelong immunity. However, these vaccines can't be given to people with weak immune systems. There's also a small risk that the virus will mutate and revert back to its original ability to replicate in humans. For example, the oral polio vaccine has a high risk of mutating and causing paralytic polio, which is why the oral vaccine is no longer used in the US. Inactivated vaccines are made by killing or deactivating the virus completely so that it can't reproduce at all, which means it can't cause disease. The polio, rabies, and hepatitis A vaccines are examples of inactivated vaccines. The pathogen is inactivated using heat or chemicals like formaldehyde, which destroys the virus's ability to replicate but leaves it recognizable to your immune system. Inactivated vaccines are advantageous because the inactivated virus cannot cause even a mild form of the disease, and these vaccines can be given to people with compromised immune systems. However, it usually takes several doses to achieve immunity, so additional booster shots will be needed. A subunit or conjugate vaccine involves removing one part of the virus and using it to provide immunity. These types of vaccines can be created created in a few different ways. One method involves isolating a specific protein in the virus and presenting it on its own as an antigen. These virus-like particles, or VLPs, contain no genetic material and so can't cause illness, but still prompt an immune response which triggers memory cells and provides future protection from the virus. Yet another method uses genetic engineering to insert the genetic code from a disease-causing virus into another harmless virus to create what's called a recombinant vaccine. Your immune system will recognize the genetic coding of the virus, and memory cells will provide future immunity. Both types of vaccines can be used on people with weakened immune systems, and one or two doses usually provides lifetime immunity. The hepatitis B and human papillomavirus, or HPV, vaccines were both created through genetic engineering. But some diseases are caused by bacteria rather than viruses. Toxoid vaccines can be created to provide immunity against bacterial infections that are caused by the toxins released from the bacteria. Toxoid vaccines are created in a similar fashion to inactivated viral vaccines. The toxins are treated with heat or chemicals to create a toxoid, which is similar enough to produce an immune response, but cannot cause disease. For example, tetanus infections are caused by the Clostridium tetani bacteria, but the symptoms are actually caused by the neurotoxin tetanospasmin, which is released as the bacteria reproduces. The tetanus vaccine is a toxoid vaccine that teaches your immune system how to respond to the neurotoxin rather than to the bacteria itself. Passive immunity is created when you inject a person with antibodies, which immediately destroy pathogens. While you don't have to wait for your body to generate its own antibodies, like with most vaccines, the protection is usually only temporary. One of the most important parts of any vaccination strategy is the concept of herd immunity. When a significant portion of a population is vaccinated, it makes it difficult for a virus to travel from person to person, limiting its spread. Herd immunity is essential for protecting vulnerable people who can't be vaccinated, like very young children, older individuals, and people with compromised immune systems. These groups also tend to be the most at risk for complications from viral infections, so they're depending on herd immunity to protect them. Thanks to vaccines and the concept of herd immunity, smallpox has been completely eradicated. We've almost eliminated polio, many other diseases are held in check, and we're well on our way to creating vaccines for countless other viruses. Vaccines are truly one of the most important medical advances in history. If you enjoyed learning about how vaccines are made, be sure to check out our other videos, like this one, called What Made the Black Death So Deadly? Or perhaps you'll like this other video instead. As always, thanks for watching, and don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. See you next time.